Good morning.
I'm really excited today. Why? Because if you're watching us live online, you're going to hear us better and see us better. So we're hopeful that all of you it was easy for you to get in. And for those of you that are here, we're also going to have a much better ability for you to take a look again if you'd like to hear the sermon a second time or even participate in the worship music a second time. We're absolutely hopeful that our recordings are going to be a lot better as a result of our movement away from Facebook and onto Zoom. So God bless you all this morning, and we say thank you, Lord, for our technology. Thank you, Lord, that we're able to reach people. We know, Lord, that we were discussing yesterday how some that listen and hear us are on all different parts of our world. And so we ask, Lord, that those that are going through the change of understanding where they can see and hear us, that they get it, because we want to spread your good news. We say, come, Holy Spirit, come. We lift our time together this morning to you, and we praise you and we thank you. There's a little bit of sprinkle of rain out there that helps us to remember that it is springtime, and there's a little bit of warmth in the air taking away the chill of winter. We ask, Lord, that for each one of us, we take this springtime and say, bring new life, not only in the creation, which you do so well, but bring new life in each and every one of us, Lord. Help us to open our hearts and say, come, Holy Spirit, come. Fill us up, Lord. Give us your strength. Give us your wisdom. Heal our bodies if our bodies need healing. We praise you and thank you, Lord, that when we come boldly before your throne, your will is done. Your will that will heal things that should never be healed, but yet they are, because it's you, Lord. And we know, Lord Jesus, that you told us that we will be able to do all of these things that you are doing, Lord Jesus, when you are here, and even more. So we say, in such a time as this, let us go forth into the darkness with bright, shining lanterns of your light. And for each and every person that we're asked to touch, help us to overflow with your joy and your excitement that there's good news. There's an eternity awaiting all of those that say yes while they're here on earth. And we say, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Thy kingdom come here with us now, Lord, this morning. We lift up the worship team to you, Lord, as they're going to bring forward your praise and thanksgiving for all that you have done for us, Lord. We lift up our time in the sermon where we're going to go back and take a look at a man who was extremely filled with you, Lord, and went through a time that we would say, oh, Lord, we're not so sure, but yet we know in you, Lord, we can do all things. So we thank you, Lord God, for our opportunity to come forward on this day and praise you and thank you and hear you and be renewed once again. It's in your holy and precious name that we lift our time together. Amen.
Good morning again. As we start our time in worship together, we'll be doing this song called Give Me Oil in My Lamp. We haven't done it in a bit. And it says, keep me burning, keep me burning. And I'm thinking, wow, how appropriate for today's chill, right? So let us get into that spirit. Stand if you could, please, as we bring our praises to the Lord. Give me oil in my lamp, keep me burning. Give me oil in my lamp, I pray. Give me oil in my lamp, keep me burning, burning, burning. Keep me burning till the end of day. Sing, Hosanna, sing, Hosanna, sing, Hosanna to the King of Kings. Sing, Hosanna, sing, Hosanna, sing, Hosanna to the King. Give me joy in my heart, keep me praising. Give me joy in my heart, I pray. Give me joy in my heart, keep me praising, 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 keep me praising till the break of day. Sing, Hosanna, sing, Hosanna, sing, Hosanna to the King of Kings. Sing, Hosanna, sing, Hosanna, sing, Hosanna to the King. Give me peace in my heart, keep me resting. Give me peace in my heart, I pray. Give me peace in my heart, keep me resting, 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 keep me resting till the break of day. Sing, Hosanna, sing, Hosanna, sing, Hosanna to the King of Kings. Sing, Hosanna, sing, Hosanna, sing, Hosanna to the King. Give me love in my heart, keep me serving. Give me love in my heart, I pray. Give me love in my heart, keep me serving, 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 keep me serving till the break of day. Sing, Hosanna, sing, Hosanna, sing, Hosanna to the King of Kings. Sing, Hosanna, sing, Hosanna, sing. Let's sing that chorus one more time. Sing, Hosanna, sing, Hosanna, sing, Hosanna to the King of Kings. Sing, Hosanna, sing, Hosanna, sing, Hosanna to the King of Kings. You are my hiding place. You always fill my heart with songs of deliverance. Whenever I am afraid, I will trust in you. I will trust in you. Let the weak say, I am strong in the strength of the Lord. You are my hiding place. You always fill my heart with songs of deliverance. Whenever I am afraid, I will trust in you. I will trust in you. Let the weak say, I am strong in the strength of the Lord. You are my hiding place. You always fill my heart with songs of deliverance. Whenever I am afraid, I will trust in you. I will trust in you. Let the weak say, I am strong in the strength of the Lord. I will trust in you. Amen. Do we trust him today? Amen. You know, it's interesting. This morning, a couple of hours ago, as we were preparing for the musicians' rehearsal, weather forecast said 3% chance of rain, something like that, single digits. And then now it's raining. That just reminds us that who made the heavens and the earth? Who truly knows what God is going to do? The weatherman is now saying 60% chance of rain. He should probably up it a little bit if there's actually water falling. But let's now sing a song very appropriate that says, ah, the Lord God made the heavens and the earth.
Ah, Lord God, thou hast made the heavens and the earth by thy great power. Ah, Lord God, thou hast made the heavens and the earth by thine outstretched arm. Nothing is too difficult for thee. Nothing is too difficult for thee. Great and mighty God, great in counsel and mighty indeed. Nothing, nothing, absolutely nothing, nothing is too difficult for thee. Ah, Lord God, thou hast made the heavens and the earth by thy great power. Ah, Lord God, thou hast made the heavens and the earth by thine outstretched arm. Nothing is too difficult for thee. Nothing is too difficult for thee. Great and mighty God, great in counsel and mighty indeed. Nothing, nothing, absolutely nothing, nothing is too difficult for thee.
Amen. Absolutely.
That was
nothing.
A short version, huh?
I'm hiding behind the camera.
I'm hiding behind my drone stick.
I hope they couldn't see me. Yeah. At this time, let us worship the Lord with our tithes and our offerings. You can come through the side aisles, make your way back through the middle if you would, please. Online, you can go to clintonnazarene.org. We show faith back to Him that has provided so faithfully to us. Stand and lift up our hands, for the joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down and worship Him now. How great, how awesome is He, and together we sing. Everyone sing. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. The earth is filled with His glory. Stand and lift up our hands, for the joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down and worship Him now. How great,
How awesome is He? And together we sing. Everyone sing. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. The earth is filled with His glory. It is rising up all around. It's the anthem of the Lord's renown. It is rising up all around. It's the anthem of the Lord's renown. And together we sing. Everyone sing. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. The earth is filled with His glory. The earth is filled with His glory. Holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. Holy, holy. Holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. Holy.
Hello again. So I'm wearing a dress that has little horses all over it. And it didn't even like connect to the fact that yesterday was the Kentucky Derby. And there was a little horse. Someone's going to have to give me that little horse's name. But there was a little horse that won that race yesterday. And when they were talking about that little horse, they just kept saying, so much heart. Was sold originally for $1,000. Just ran and would never let anybody pass her. Isn't that an amazing thing? And so as we think and we go into our announcements this morning and we think about this first announcement, which is evangelism as a lifestyle. We don't have to pay the Lord $1,000 to run the race. He paid for us. And because we're in the race, He asks us with all that we have to run it and not just run it for ourselves, but run it so that everyone else can see. Not just us running the race, but our Lord Jesus Christ. So evangelism as a lifestyle is in part about us maybe first saying, Lord, who did you create me to be in this race? Am I going to be that little horse that's out in front? Am I going to be in the middle of the pack? Am I going to be behind, bringing up the rear, but yet still in the race? And am I going to do everything, Lord, that you ask me to do when you bring one of your broken children to me? Am I going to tell them about you? So evangelism as a lifestyle, we had like a teaching a few weeks ago, and then last week we came and we sat around downstairs and we talked about, there's a some teaching in the scripture, further teaching in the scripture that we can look at. But we also talked about some of the experiences that we're having out there with those people, those children. They're all children. I saw one yesterday. I said, God loves you. And he said, no, he doesn't. Yes, he does. Well, you can think that, he said. You're not open-minded to think that he can't. And I said, yeah, but he loves you anyway. And so even in those little moments, and then they walk away and you pray on them and you say, Lord, help him remember the words, God loves you. So come out tonight, if you feel you can, because really we're just sitting around casually, or in the beginning, maybe some teaching. You know, we have Nancy giving us some teaching from scripture that helps to embolden us a little bit to really understand why God wants us to do this. And then we just share the everyday experiences that we have. So come out tonight. We'll feed you 5:30. The next announcement is also very important. I don't know if I have a further update from the number 39. 40. The number 40 is now the number of children that are signed up for our VBS event in July, and we're all so excited. I just got the God bumps all over me. It's just so exciting that this is happening. And it's Mystery Island, and today we're going to have a planning meeting after Sunday school. We'll shorten up the adult Sunday school a little bit so we can get started right at 12:30, just to talk about the planning, because we're going to need lots of people. Some of the parents are signing up to help, but for the most part, this is our opportunity. This morning we were downstairs preparing the goodies, and we said, wait, you know, I said, people don't like to come out early because the pay isn't very good here. But then we said, you know what retirement is? Retirement is servanthood. And servanthood is going to be there with us for eternity. Amen? So we can start practicing what that looks like here. And not all of us can do the same kinds of things, but we need every one of you. And certainly pray that all the workers, we have all the workers that we need, and pray for the children and pray for their parents, because it's a real opportunity for us to touch the lives. So stay today if you can. And then associated with that, this week, May 4th, is at 7 o'clock, we're going to do some training, because it's important that you understand kind of like where the government is on all of the how we care for children. It's important for us as a church community, and I think you'll be surprised at some of the material that is in there, so it's really important for you to broaden your perspective. So either May 4th at 7, it's not both times, it's just either May 4th, which is Tuesday night at 7 o'clock here in the sanctuary, or next Saturday morning at 10 a.m., two different sessions. If you've been through it before, we just probably need to be working with you to make sure you've been fingerprinted. And if you haven't been through it before, it's important, especially if you're planning on being on the property at our event. So those are the announcements for today. Oh, well, okay. So we have moved. It says Sunday services May 9th, but we have moved. And in case you weren't aware, it's helpful. This is mainly for those that are in the room, because if you're online with us, you know. Or if you're watching us on replay and you didn't know that we were live on Zoom, then certainly this lets you know that you can get the link to the Zoom call each Sunday morning right on our home page of our webpage. It's actually going to be easier than what we were doing with Facebook, and the quality is going to be a lot better. So make sure you have Zoom if you haven't used Zoom before, and you know that sometimes you might want to watch us live online. Make sure that it's either you can do it on your phone, or you can do it on your home computer, but just make sure that you have Zoom. And if you have Zoom already set up, then it's just a matter of clicking on the link and waiting if it says the host has not arrived yet. So a little bit of patience there, but once we're live, and you can come in anytime, and the recording, the full recording, will be out just as it were if you've been looking for it already. It's out on YouTube. We'll have the link to it on the homepage, as we always have. It just, you'll see a lot better quality and a lot better sound out there in that recording. So let's go before the Lord with the Word of God. This morning, our sermon is entitled, and this is important, A Deliverer, Learned Prince, and Warrior Recluse. And we'll be reading from Acts chapter 7, verses 17 through 29. Stephen continued, "But when the time of the promise drew near, which God had sworn to Abraham, the people grew and multiplied in Egypt until another king arose who did not know Joseph. This man dealt treacherously with our people and oppressed our forefathers, making them expose their babies so they might not live. At this time, Moses was born and was well-pleasing to God, and he was brought up in his father's house for 3 months. But when he was set out, Pharaoh's daughter took him away and brought him up as her own son. And Moses was learned in all the wisdom of the Egyptians and was mighty in words and deeds. Now, when he was 40 years old, it came into his heart to visit brethren, the children of Israel. And seeing one of them suffer wrong, he defended and avenged him who was oppressed and struck down the Egyptian. For he supposed that his brethren would have understood that God would deliver them by his hand, but they did not understand. And the next day he appeared to two of them as they were fighting and tried to reconcile them, saying, 'Men, you are brethren. Why do you wrong one another?' But he who did his neighbor wrong pushed him away, saying, 'Who made you ruler and judge over us? Do you want to kill me as you did the Egyptian yesterday?' Then at this saying, Moses fled and became a dweller in the land of Midian, where he had two sons." The word of the Lord.
Good morning, everyone. Well, I'm pleased to be here with you this morning to bring you this second message of Stephen's defense of the entire history of humanity according to God and his word. And so we come to this second part, a deliverer, a learned prince, and a warrior recluse. This is the life of Moses. Last week we talked about a deliverer, did we not? And that deliverer was Joseph. And he was able to keep the people alive and to give them a place and a place to prosper. And we heard earlier, just a couple seconds ago, as Pastor Laurie was reading, that the Lord blessed the people of Israel and they grew mighty in number. But this also led to the problem then of people wanting to not want them around. So we have this first 40 years of Moses' life that we're going to be talking about, how he was raised up. And there was compassion by the princess of Egypt on this child. And he was learned in every way of the Egyptians. And at that time, folks, other than maybe China or Persia, there was no greater learning in the world. It'd be like going to the finest university and studying for 12 or 15, maybe 16 years. So he knew a lot. Then his next 40 years we'll talk about too, after this incident where he kills the man trying to hurt his own people, and then spends 40 years as a nomadic shepherd in the wilderness and becomes a recluse to hide away. So let's go back and again, constantly reminding you, what was Stephen's supposed evil and crime that he had committed? What was it that he was accused of at this trial? Blaspheming. That is, speaking an untruth against God's word concerning the following four major topics. Interpretation of the scripture, God's word, and we started talking about that last week, how he passed that test as far as God was concerned. But also the title of prophet. That would be the prophet Moses. And so now we begin to start this defense of what about Moses? Who was he? What was he and what wasn't he? And then the temple and traditions will come later, the significance and sacredness of that, and the commandments and the covenant of the law given by Moses. He was also accused of insurrection against the religion of the Jewish people, against the Roman Empire, against all the different things going on. He was also accused of desecration and preaching heresy, complete untruth to the Jewish people about who the Messiah really was. But specifically concerning the sacredness of the Temple Mount and the authority of the religious priests, especially the Sanhedrin Council, which he was before. Now, this heretical teaching, according to them, was that Jesus of Nazareth was a man, not he was just a son of man, but he was also adding that he was Christ the Messiah, Son of God, and he would be the final deliverer of all time following Moses. Stephen begins his defense by going back to God's prophetic word concerning God's direct involvement in the history of humanity. He started all the way back with Abraham. Where did the promise come from? Where did the covenant start after the Noahic flood? And Stephen teaches that God is to be obeyed at any cost. And his life actually shows that as he stands there and obeys God in defense of God. But he also tells us that we need today to be ready to respond to God's leading at a moment's notice. Stephen, that morning, was being harassed, but he was brought right in front of the tribunal. He had no time to prepare as people prepare. When you go to trial, don't you like to be able to talk to your lawyer, talk to your defense counsel, whatever, right? You don't just jump into it. Stephen had to jump right into it, and he's reminding us that that could happen to us today. We don't know what will come. Be ready. That we need to be pliable in our mind, spirit, and body to take the Lord's direction and not our own way. Today we're going to read about how Moses did it in his own way, and it got him in trouble because he murdered somebody, and then he had to run. Stephen says, don't rely on tradition, and don't rely on your own understanding, but acknowledge him in all of your ways, and he will direct your voice, your steps, and your path. Stephen's defense of the gospel highlights this primary concept throughout all five parts of the defense, that God's direction, God's will, and God's intervention within the history of humanity always happens, and it always centers around this major theme. And this is the theme you want to be telling everybody about. When Lori said to that man, God loves you, and he couldn't believe it. This is the main thing that they need to understand, what that love looks like, that God has a plan and a purpose for every human being. He knew that plan and purpose for you, and he knew it for that man before he was ever born. It says in the scripture that God knew us before we were born, and he already was in love with us before we were ever born. He gave us this time in history that we stand here now to give an accounting of that love. So God's plan and purpose is unique. It's also, though, for all of his people together around the world as he's calling a family. That calling has a covenantal promise. I will be with you always. I will heal you. I will save you. I will protect you. I will provide for you. Those are the promises of the covenant. But the ultimate promise is to send a one-time deliverer, the prophet of all time, the Messiah, the Christ, his only begotten Son, that in his life, that plan will be fulfilled, and that if you accept him by the power of the Holy Spirit as Lord and Savior of your life, you will own the promise, because the one who gives it, the life giver, the giver of faith, the Holy Spirit, will be a down payment in your heart to prove the existence of that promise and the proof that that covenant will be kept. This is Stephen's defense. Stephen's defense of the gospel also highlights, again, all of the problems with us. Here's the problem. We have all fallen. We've all chosen our own way. We have all sinned. The purpose of the law was to show us where we were not measuring up. There's a role for the priesthood. There's a role for ministers today to lead people, to shepherd people, but not to rule over them. The purpose of the temple and true worship of God is to worship him in spirit and in truth, not by any tradition. Jesus said to the woman at the well, I tell you, there's a time coming, no, it already is, when they won't worship on this mountain, or this way, or that way. But the true worshipers of God will worship him by the Spirit within them. And the mission of the coming Messiah is to set everyone free, not some. God doesn't condemn some and save some. God calls all, because God created all. God loves all, and God wants all to respond. This calling that you offer this week when you talk to people is universal. It's the love of God poured out in the life and death and resurrection of the deliverer, Jesus the Christ. So here we go, looking at today's scripture in a verse-by-verse style. Stephen's first defense says, God will always provide and he will always sustain. Even in your worst moments, he will provide and sustain. Stephen continued, but when the time of the promise drew near, which God had sworn to Abraham, the people were growing and multiplying and taking over the land. Do you see that provision and that sustainment? That's what it was like for us and our founding fathers and mothers when they reached this shore. God provided and sustained them even though they had hardships. He brought them through wars of liberty and independence. And he always provided a witness, even if it was only 3, 4, 5% of the people. There was always a witness to setting people free. But it cost them everything. What we have forgotten in America today is no matter of knowledge, no matter how much I study, no matter how many degrees I get as a learned prince before you, it profits me nothing if I do not have the love of God and his presence. Paul said, I can give my body to the flames to be burnt. I can give everything I have to the poor, but it profits me nothing if I do not own, have, and give away the love of God. And so it was for Moses. He grew up and he learned and learned. But all he had was hate in him, because what did he do? He murdered. All the knowledge in the world won't change our fallen nature. No matter of college or university, no extra seminar or extra training session will ever change the human heart, because it's wicked above all else, left to itself. And Moses is proof of this. But God still loves us and sustains us. Isn't that amazing? We're not worthy, and he provides anyway. Right now, our country is the most unworthy I've ever seen it. And maybe me with it, I don't even know anymore. But God still is providing, is he not? Stephen's defense then goes to the persecution and suffering that's coming, so that God will be a faithful, persevering God. Look what he says. Then another king arose that did not know Joseph. Then another illegitimate person took the throne. Sound familiar? And this man dealt treacherously with the people. That's what's happening to us right now. Treachery. And they began to oppress our forefathers. That's coming. You better get ready. Laws are being passed that aren't even constitutional anymore. And they made them expose their babies so they might not live. You know what the trouble with our society is? We give up our babies to the flames. We celebrate the death of our children. They were trying to save theirs from the unholy sacrifice of Pharaoh. But what is abortion today? What is it? It's an unholy what? You see, there's so many similarities, because nothing ever changes under the sun, does it? From time to time, we go right back and repeat our past. And then Stephen says, but you know what? God made you a promise anyway. And even when this oppression comes to you, he's still with you. At this time, he gave them a deliverer. Guess who was born? Moses. Do you think he knew it? No way. We're going to find out a lot about his life, how he tries to run from everything. I got news for you. I don't know if I'd have wanted his job at all. But look what it says. Something about him was well-pleasing to God. Something, his potential was well-pleasing. What he could be, that's encouraging to us, is it not? What we could be is what? Pleasing to God. Not our past sins. God doesn't remember it anymore when you come to him, does he? He forgets it. He forgives. He moves on with you. Yes or no? You're pretty quiet this morning. And he was brought up for 3 months, just barely enough to give him enough sustenance to probably make a day's journey. Because babies at 3 months need how much milk, how fast? And then it just says when he was set out. Next week, Pastor Lori's going to talk about being set out on the river. Jochebed with her heart broken. Miriam, her daughter, to try to watch over him. Crocodiles, alligators, large sea serpents and snakes. There was nothing good on that river. And if he was found by an Egyptian, more than likely what? Turned over to be terminated. But when he was set out, and this knowledge that Stephen says is that, but God had him in his hands. That little ark, that little covered basket, right in the hand of God. He was going to take it downriver, right where he wanted it to go. And where did it wind up? But when he was set out, who took pity? Whose motherly compassion? Women, listen to me. We need to get back to being women. We need to have the compassion and the love of God, and we need to show it in every way. And we need to help our sisters who are reveling in everything that they shouldn't be reveling in as women. I'll preach the same thing to fathers when the time comes in June. But she took him and she brought him up as her own. Think of the defiance. Think of the defiance here. If she gets caught, what? Not only is he going to be terminated, but you will be exiled from the royal house and made a peasant if they don't behead you on the spot. She's going to defy her brother. She's going to defy her father. She's going to defy the ones who want to murder, because in a woman's heart, the way God made her, defense of life and giving life is all there is. How many women can say amen to that? And she took great care of him. And then he tells us about this learned prince. And so he grew up for 40 years, and Moses was learned during this 40 years all the wisdom of the Egyptians. All, did you see that? All the wisdom of the Egyptians. So Moses must have had a mind that could do what? Take a lot in. Because the Egyptians knew just about everything by this point. It's the greatest of the seven wonders of the world. Which ones still exist today on the plain in Giza? The pyramids. Building, architecture, mathematics, physics. But he probably also spoke many languages, because they did back then, not just the common tongue. It also says he was mighty in word and deed. What does this mean? He was a warrior. All princes went to war, all of them. Chariots, riders, behind the generals, out there making strategy, even getting involved in conflict. And so how many wars did the Egyptians have? About every 5 years they were at war with somebody. So if in a 40-year period he grew up to be 20, he probably was involved in 3 or 4 major skirmishes by the time he was 40. He had proved himself to be what? Great in battle, mighty indeed, strong, courageous, with all this knowledge. Today, I think we rely too much on our own abilities. I see so many people, well, you just don't understand. I have a specialty in that. You can have all the special training you want, but if you don't know what you're talking about, I really don't care. See, opinions are like body parts. We all have them. Logic and reason and the truth of the Word of God and the real history of the world is all that matters. Because that is the truth. And it doesn't change because you took another seminar. It doesn't change because this happened. And Moses knew that, but he was missing one thing. He was missing the presence of God. And all the knowledge in the world, what do we say, is just worthless without him. He had to learn that over the next 40 years of his life. Be nice to know you're going to live to be 120 and blow off 40 for learning and 40 for being a recluse and 40 for getting the work done. Except I don't think I'd spend the last 40 getting the work done. But anyway, God does what God does. And so this great learned man still lacked love, compassion, understanding, but he had a lot to be valued. And Stephen says this, we have such a need for family and belonging, and I see families together this morning. What would you do if that loved one next to you just wasn't there anymore? How much would be different? How much less would you be if they weren't sitting next to you? Talked to my daughter this week about family, and she said, I'm going to come up with all four kids for the VBS, spend a month with you, Dad. You just got to come halfway to get me. What a deal. Son-in-law to follow. And so that made 40, went from 36 to 40, because I had four right there. Poof, okay? You know what's crazy? Is that God is sending us some very, very interesting things about the first verse this morning. That he would grow us and multiply us and make us great in the world so that his voice could be heard. We have 40 kids, and are you ready for this? We have three sets of twins and a set of triplets. And one family has a double and a triple in that with all five. Now, do you know what the odds are? Do you know what the odds are of having 9 out of 40 kids be from doubles and triples in a normal distribution of people in the earth? It's about a 24% incidence rate of extras. You know what the rate is in the general population? Less than 2%. So what does that tell you about the kind of people that are gravitating towards us? They're blessed by whom? God. I don't know. I just was blessed by writing down those names and looking at those dates in that spreadsheet. Amen. So when he was 40 years old, it came into his heart that he should probably be concerned about who he really was, because don't think Pharaoh's daughter didn't tell him, and don't think Jochebed hadn't, when she was his nursemaid, informed him that he was a Hebrew underneath it all. And he began to see the slavery in a different way, and his mind became quite vengeful. When we see injustice, men, I'm talking to you mostly, when we see injustice, you know what we do? First thing we do is we want to get in there and do something about it, amen? But a lot of times, our passion gets ahead of our thinking. Can I get an amen from any man out there this morning?
Amen.
All right. So we want to just go take care of it. However that needs to be, who cares? Let's get it fixed, right? And guess what? Moses was no different. He saw his people being beaten. He started to understand who he was. And it started to get to him, this slavery, this oppression, this injustice. And Stephen tells us next that one of the things of a deliverer is strength, but one of the things a deliverer should never be is vengeful. But they both kind of come together, especially in testosterone-driven people. And seeing one of them suffer so wrongly, he immediately defended, but then avenged him who was oppressed, and he struck down, he murdered the Egyptian taskmaster. In the real scripture, what does it tell us? He even buried him in the sand, hoping nobody would find him until he rotted. For he supposed that his brothers would understand, right? If I do this for you and I'm a prince, hey, I'm the deliverer. By my own hand, look at the problem. See? When we do it in our strength, then something goes wrong. And immediately, what happened? They didn't get it. As a matter of fact, they say, what do you want to do, kill us too? What are you, another oppressor? You're not a deliverer. Because the people had lost their hope, and Moses was trying to do it by himself. Then it tells us that, I went the wrong way. Then it tells us about our fallen nature some more. And the next day he appeared to two of them fighting and tried to reconcile. And they said, what do you want to do? Do us wrong as well? But he who did his neighbor pushed him away saying, who made you ruler? Who made you judge? We don't want somebody like you. We just want to be free. And this isn't going to help us. And so the accusation went out of murder, and guess what? It went to Pharaoh's house, and in no time there was an arrest warrant for guess who? Stephen's defense is, what do we usually do when we've done something wrong? We run and we, that's what we do. Remember in the garden when Adam and Eve messed up? What'd they do? They hid themselves in the bushes. As if God doesn't have infrared. I mean, you know, it's like, you ever see the movie Predator? Right? Flips the lens down, heat signature. We forget we're 98.6 on average, and that shows up really nice and bright in green foliage. It's like, you know, wherever the room temperature is or ambient temperature. And besides, remember how he used to walk with Adam and Eve and hold their hands in the cool of the day, and now they're going to try to hide from his presence? Well, we all do it, don't we? You ever notice that when you do something really wrong, you don't spend time praying? You don't spend time reading God's word? Why? Because you're ashamed and you feel guilty and you think, well, he won't want to spend any time with me. That's the time you should be spending with him, because now you really need daddy. I remember when I was a kid, there was a song that came out when I was a little bit older that expressed my father, Daddy's Hands. Have you ever heard that? It's a country and western song. My daddy's hands could fix anything. If I had a broken toy, he could fix it. If I had a broken bicycle, he could fix it. My dad was a jack of all trades. He was a farmer, and I think the guy could fix anything. He'd always tell me, you know, right now I'm trying to deal with something where part of the part isn't here. But then my dad would even go out and forge it. When I think of Mike Brady, I think of that. When I think of Mike Lambert, he'd make a part. He'd weld a part. He would do whatever. But when I did something wrong in my household, the last person I wanted to face was him. Because I also knew his hands could be, just like the song said, very hard. Believe me, I felt a few. And Moses runs. He's just like us. Well, this failed. All my knowledge and all my ability in battle and everything that I built my whole life on, and I screwed up, and now the people don't want me. And I'm ashamed of everything that I am, and I just hope they won't find me. He runs off to Midian, what a place, where it's always hot and always cold at night. Temperatures of 130 sometimes in the summer, Fahrenheit. Temperatures of 38 to 36 degrees at night. You get tested. And for 40 years, this reclusive shepherd ran around the desert. And you know what? God did not talk to him during that time. It's very apparent. He spent 39 years of that 40 doing it his own way, but doing it with nobody noticing except, you know, I'll raise a family. And then the last year of that 40 years, God has that burning bush, you know, that thing that's burning, but it doesn't get consumed. And all the science in the world and all the math in the world and all that learned prince says that can't happen. I did learn about gods in the Egyptian pantheon, but who is this one? My parents were Hebrews, and they believed in one God, but is this one? And the recluse finally had a question that needed answering. Stephen's defense said that even though he wasn't living his life for God, are you ready? 79 years, God was still blessing him. He was faithful because he gave him what? Two sons. So you know what? We can be raising families and not know God. And God can be blessing us. And And we can be taking it for granted because we don't even know. But then when we come to know him, we do know. But God's still blessing because that's his job. Because he's always good and he's always faithful, even when we're not. Amen? Praise be to God. I want to take you back now and remind you this is where he's going to leave his defense here till he picks up this deliverer actually coming back to be a deliverer next week. What were those accusations? That he had blasphemed the scripture and the title of prophet for Moses. Do you see anything in here, though, of his defense that goes against those? Not in any way. Once again, Stephen is faithful to the true history, the true scripture, the word of God. His face is still shining like an angel. He's really starting to feel his mettle. You can see him starting to build as he's telling the story. And the Spirit speaks every word, and he's still at peace. And they still just see the shining face of one from heaven. Stephen, instead of failing, has laid the foundation for a promise, a covenant, and a vision of a future deliverer. Although that deliverer will be a learned prince of Egypt, he's also right now just a warrior recluse in the desert, running from God, his calling, and his people. And I want to say something right now to every Christian out there. Even though the government is doing what the government should not do, we cannot do this on our own. We cannot in our own power, just in our own power, come against them. We need to be on the side of right. And even in the fight that's coming, if we do not offer salvation and love and forgiveness in the midst even of what might be war, we will fail. Because in the survival mode that might be over the horizon, if we're not offering the hope of eternity, what good will it do us to survive? What good will it do us to fight even if we won? If all we did was secure a man-made, woman-made, humanity-made peace that is not the peace that God wants us to have. So as you come against oppression, as you come against injustice, as you come against the unconstitutionality of what's going on, remember people need eternal hope right alongside of the fight. Because the fight is never really the fight. It's always what's behind it, the spiritual war that the devil is actually doing. And do not forget that many of these people who are doing it, many of them are deceived themselves, and they need a savior. Only about 5 or 10% of humanity is willingly deceived and working for Satan. Most do not even know how dark is the dark that makes them stumble. And that includes many of our elected officials. You have to be at war. You have to be at peace. You have to fight. You have to offer hope. You have to be living and ever living all at the same time. Not hard, right? But so it was for Moses. He had to come and deliver, but he had to do it God's way. He had to fight when God said fight. He had to hide when God said hide. He had to camp when God said camp. He had to move when God said move. He had to rely on him for everything in the wilderness, from food and water to the breath of life. So it must be with us. If we're going to deliver this world from the foundation that Satan is setting, that it must be on the bedrock of the cornerstone of our faith, Jesus Christ our Lord, the deliverer. Don't forget that. Don't forget that in the fight. Because if you do, you will face judgment and you will lose. Because the Prince of Peace And the warrior of heaven is the one and the same. And he will judge every intent of our heart. May it be pure. May it only be to save, not only in this life and the troubles that are coming, but in the next where there's no trouble at all. May we be about God's business as Moses was about God's business. Therefore, let us do the same thing that Stephen did. Let us give a witness and a defense today and tomorrow of the hope that is in us, that we might bring many into the kingdom of heaven as a small deliverer for the one who has delivered us, the deliverer. Please rise and let me pray for you. Lord God, make us like Stephen, to stand with faces of angels, but with the strength of warriors. Let us stand with the truth, but offer love. Let us be resolved never to give in to anything except to your Spirit's movement. And let us be bold to give a defense of you, even if this is our last day. And let us be as strong that day as we are today in the living, that we might stand before you with faces like angels, because you have made us holy, and you have called us apart, and you have made us a royal priesthood, a holy people, a holy nation. Make us to be like you, our deliverer, O Lord Jesus Christ. And to you we bow our knee again this week, and we say, we will serve you, and we will reach the lost, we will seek the oppressed, and we will serve everyone with the love that you have for us. And all of God's people said.
You're right, Pastor. That is not a hard task at all. How do I know that? God said, "Fear not, for I am with you." Let's pray this. Fear not, for I am with you. Fear not, for I am with you, fear not. For I am with you, says the Lord. Fear not, for I am with you, fear not. For I am with you, fear not. For I am with you, says the Lord. I have redeemed you, I have called you by name. Child, you are mine. When you walk through the waters, I will be there. And through the flames, you'll not be drowned. You'll not be burned. For I am with you. Fear not, for I am with you. Fear not, for I am with you. Fear not. For I am with you, says the Lord. Fear not, for I am with you, fear not. For I am with you, fear not. For I am with you, says the Lord. I have redeemed you, I have called you by name. Child, you are mine. When you walk through the waters, I will be there. And through the flames, you'll not be drowned, you'll not be burned, for I am with you. Fear not, for I am with you, fear not. For I am with you, fear not. For I am with you, says the Lord. Fear not. For I am with you, fear not. For I am with you, fear not. For I am with you, says the Lord. Fear not. Amen.
Fear not. Let's say this benediction together. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. God bless you all. Have a wonderful day.